Ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to you. One might be forgiven for thinking that someone who is chair of the Common Wards, a member of the First World War Centenary Culture Committee, and a governor of the Royal Shakespeare Company already had quite a lot on his plate, but that is the very beginning of the engagements and breadths of work for our speaker this evening. Sir Anthony Seldon, a very distinguished educationalist. I'm sure many of you know his background in education. He is, of course, Vice Chancellor of the University of Buckingham, University of the Year, very recently, and also the university excelling in teaching quality, all qualities to which we all aspire. He is also, amongst his many other attributes, a Fellow of the Royal Historical Society and of King's College London, knighted in 2014 in the Queen's Birthday Honours List for services to education and to modern political history. I am certain we are in for an absolute treat this evening in hearing Sir Anthony's very particular insights into modern politics, particularly as they centre around number 10. I'm hoping to learn about rooms that one would normally ever get access to and the conversations in corridors that go along with them. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sir Anthony Seldon.
So thank you, Peter, for that very kind and generous introduction. And I am just so thrilled to be here at the university where you are the chair. I was an alumnus here. I did my MBA here, and I learned so much about how to run organizations. And number 10 is just another organization. And in many ways, it's not a very, throughout its history, it hasn't been a very successful organization. I don't think that the office manager of number 10 throughout most of the 296 years would have got an MBA from Westminster University, or indeed from the Polytechnic of Central London, which was the iteration that it was when I took my own degree. And I think I learnt more. I definitely learnt more on my MBA than I did studying PPE at another institution. That was partly my fault, but also it was partly because I think that philosophy and indeed economics and politics had become increasingly the domain of the academic and academic debate and argument rather than relating to the real world of the economic activity of companies and governments, of the political systems, and indeed meaningful philosophy. So there we are. I am going to be talking about what I completely love. I fell in love with this building when I was at junior school, given a book about it by my parents called Our Democracy, and I still get that incredible thrill every time I go down the corridor, down the street into number 10 and through that front door and down the long corridor. So we're going to talk, we've got quite a challenge today. I was slightly frightened when I see this, when I read it on the train. So we've got 300 years of PMs at number 10. And blimey, I've also seen to have thrown in 11 cabinet secretaries who work with them. So this is what we've got. It's going to be a romp, not the kind of romp that students from the University of Westminster would have if they weren't so serious students and just bent on their books and computer screens through 54 prime ministers, and they're going to be 185 slides covering 296 years. And in 45 minutes, and there's going to be a three-minute video to boot. So how on earth are we going to make these numbers work? I haven't a clue. And I do want to have 11 amazing questions coming out of you at the end of this talk. So, without further ado, we're going to begin by looking through how many American presidents have there been? 45, the 45th being President Trump, and maybe debatable, and there have been 54 prime ministers, so we can see that the average length of time, very similar between the head of the United States and the head of the UK, 54 British prime ministers, but the first British prime minister, 1721, so they were in existence for 50 years before the American and more just over the American presidency. So average length of office, very similar. And of course, the American president, however, you would immediately say, well, you know, the American president is head of state. But I would say to you that the British Prime Minister has increasingly become, to all intents and purposes, the head of state also. It's quite hard to distinguish the roles of the British Prime Minister, which are not the head of state, and they've also become the Foreign Secretary too. So in this office, head of government, head of party, head of the executive, national leader at times of crisis, but at times of peace, also representing the nation, increasingly taking over the role of the Foreign Secretary, not to diminish in any sense the power of the head of state. And I think it would be a challenge for Charles when he takes over to keep hold of the remaining powers and authorities that the monarchy has, many of which reside in the peculiar personality and gifts of Queen, and I'm sure he'll do it in his own way, but the trend has been very much to centralisation of power in this figure of the Prime Minister. So, first Prime Minister, interesting, like the first Cabinet Secretary, longest serving person here, and there he is. And this is going to be such a romp, but you're going to have to remember their names for so I said there are 11 questions we're fitting into the hour, and there also is a 20-question test at the end of it. Any of these could come there. And you don't just have to remember their names and their dates and their length of service, but also what they are wearing, too. So you have to. You're laughing. But you won't be later. And there we are. Extraordinary Walpole. Extraordinary, deceitful, dishonest, corrupt, but very successful. And very successful, I should say, probably. Wilmington, who, if I'd asked, how many here would have known who the second Prime Minister was, had I asked you? Hands up, anybody? Anybody there shouting out no? Who knows what the third one is? These people, in just 4 years' time, in 2021, we're going to have the 300th anniversary of the British Prime Minister. 1721 Walpole. I mean, there's some people would see in from 1688 onwards first ministers who have some of that authority. But I am absolutely clear that Walpole is the first. And then in 1735, 14 years after he came to power, moved into Downing Street. But these figures here are little known. Pelham, 10 years. 10 years. We should know Pelham, one of the four great prime ministers in this first phase of Treasury prime ministers, I think we can call them, in the five phases, Treasury prime ministers, 18th century imperial prime ministers, in the 19th, then from 1916, Lloyd George, through to 1945, total war prime ministers, then welfare state prime ministers, and then European prime ministers, and now we're clearly into post-European. So there's five phases, I think, of premiership. Pelham, one of the four great 18th century prime ministers in the Treasury phase. Newcastle, again, 7 years in office. Devonshire, short time. Bute, beyond feeble. Grenville, Rockingham, if we could have a talk about any of these, but then Chatham there, a very significant figure, although albeit only Prime Minister or First Minister, as it was called at the time, for 2 years, 76 days. Grafton, we move over. Lord North, a very significant figure and unfairly maligned, perhaps for loss of a fairly significant slice of territory. Shelburne coming through there, Portland, and here we have the magnificent Pitt the Younger, the first modern British Prime Minister in office and the delineator of this next phase of premiership. Then we've got Addington throughout the Napoleonic Wars, Grenville for a short time, Percival, more on him later. Who knows what happened to Percival? Marvellous, good. Why do you all know the grisly things? Then we have Liverpool, 14 years, nearly 15 years. Can we imagine a Prime Minister serving that long now? And if not, and it would be enormously difficult, what's changed? Canning, the shortest serving, Goderich, and then we come to Wellington. One of the 11 American presidents have been distinguished in military careers. Why is it that so few British prime ministers have been military figures? What's the difference there? Earl Grey, celebrated for, not the least, for the passage of the Great Reform Act of 1832. Melbourne, celebrated for his relationship, doting, fawning, salivating over Queen Victoria. Peel, great Prime Minister, not such a great Tory party leader, if you're a Tory. Russell, Derby, Aberdeen, very interesting. Palmerston, we'll come back to him later. Palmerston, the great Foreign Secretary figure in the middle of this imperial period, the second period of Prime Ministership, the imperial Prime Minister, great growth of the Empire. Disraeli playing a very significant part in that. Look at Disraeli there, only Prime Minister for 6 years and almost just on 7 years, comparatively short for the time. Then moving on to Gladstone, 12 years, and the time's already coming down in longevity. But then we have the figure who saw the figure who blocked reform. If you are a reformer, the great Tory Andrew Roberts sees him as one of the great prime ministers of all time, profoundly orthodox and traditional. Look at the length of service there at the end of Victoria's reign, but seeing in the 20th century, but such a profoundly 19th century figure. Rosebery, ineffectual at the end of the Liberal Party period of power leadership. Balfour, probably too intellectual to be Prime Minister, not always a great requirement to be so intellectual. Campbell, Bannerman, probably the laziest person to be Prime Minister in many ways. One wishes that some other leaders had been lazy, they'd have done less damage. Here we are now into the period of total war Prime Ministers. Asquith, very successful as a peacetime Prime Minister, not successful at all as a wartime Prime Minister, and the converse there in Lloyd George, very successful, taking over on the 9th of December 1916, the month after the Battle of the Somme, 3 weeks indeed after the Battle of the Somme came to its bloody conclusion. Very successful as a wartime leader, not nearly so successful as a peacetime leader. Bonelaw, known as the Robert Blake's biography, the unknown Prime Minister, died of cancer. But a key figure. Stanley Baldwin, the figure who bestrode this middle period of the total war, Prime Minister, modernising the Conservative Party, first to understand the power of broadcasting, the power of newsreels, in wonderful old cinemas like this. Many, many newsreels of this man in the garden at 10 Downing Street, in a masterful pre-Harold Wilson kind of way, communicating in a very easy, natural style with the country. Ramsay MacDonald, Labour's first Prime Minister, but then much reviled, moved into number 10 with his daughter Ishbel. They had so little money that he and Ishbel came up to Oxford Street to buy cutlery and crockery, because no one had said that the great figures, the great landed figures, aristocratic figures who'd been Prime Minister before, moved in with all their servants and all their cutlery and crockery and furniture, and he had absolutely nothing, so he and Ishbel had to go up and find it. Chamberlain, great controversial figure, great peacetime reformer, not so successful at foreign policy, though some people, some academics, certainly argue that appeasement bought time and was necessary. Churchill there outside number 10, on to Attlee, and now we're into the fourth phase of premiership, the welfare state prime minister, and then we've had Churchill, who came back in 51-55, Anthony Eden, probably the best looking of the prime minister, not so certain, some would say there wasn't a great deal of competition, and Macmillan, but certainly YR American presidents thought to be more attractive than British prime ministers. Well, certainly one's got to give them some kind of prizes on the comparisons between the leaders of both nations. They can take that one probably. Macmillan, the prime minister who tried to take Britain into Europe and his premiership fell apart when he was denied access. And then the very brief period of Alec Douglas-Hume for just a year, and into the third Labour prime minister, Harold Wilson, who came back for two brief periods. And interestingly, the one prime minister after the war, arguably, who left number 10 at a moment of their own choosing. Just think about that when they are on the doorsteps of number 10. And if one said to them, every single post-war prime minister, arguably with the exception of Harold Wilson, was forced out, how would they feel about that? Wilson was already showing signs of the illness that was responsible for his premature death. He was only 59 when he left. One of his best jokes was he left to make way for an older man who, and there weren't many jokes, the older man was Callaghan, who succeeded Heath. Heath's towering achievement, almost all his measures in local government, in the welfare state were, and reorganisation of industry was swept away, and unions were swept away by Labour after 1974, bar his one towering achievement, which will be swept away later this month. And then Jim Callaghan, one of the best qualified men ever to come into Downing Street, and I think in many ways temperamentally very similar to Theresa May. If John Major is the most similar to Theresa May, the 54th Prime Minister, in terms of social background and being unideological, I think in the pragmatism, very similar to Jim Callaghan. And then Margaret Thatcher, the most controversial Prime Minister of the 20th century, and arguably the most controversial Prime Minister amongst historians and indeed the electorate, of the 19th and 20th centuries. And then, just coming through quickly, John Major, someone unfairly tweeted that he'd forgotten that he had taken the party to its worst post-war defeat in 1997, so how can he possibly claim to be speaking on behalf of the electorate? But we must remember in 1992 that John Major won the biggest overall tally of votes that the Conservative Party had ever won in that 1992, the improbable election that he took over 18 months after succeeding Thatcher. Tony Blair winning three general elections, making way for Gordon Brown, the 52nd. David Cameron, all set to be going at a moment of his own choosing that would have been not so very far into the future from the moment we now are. He would have prided himself, he was relishing the moment that he was going to walk out of that door and break the rule that everybody is forced out, but it wasn't to be for reasons we all know. Theresa May there, and then... It's hardly surprising she's smiling. What does she know that only we do here? And then the 55th Prime Minister after the revolution. Clearly, comrade Jeremy, he's not just going to suspend the five-year Parliament Act, but he'll suspend ageing too, and the normal laws of political logic. But who knows? I mean, who knows? I would think now that the election in 2020, even with Jeremy Corbyn, is far from certain. One thing we know about the current time is how unpredictable things are. Now, we've had 55 prime ministers. There have only been 11 cabinet secretaries. The cabinet secretaries arguably have been as influential and as powerful. I wonder how many of you can name the 11 cabinet secretaries. Set up the first one, 9th of December, 1916. First office, the cabinet office has been in four different offices. Started off in Whitehall Palace by the river, just south of Whitehall Palace and Whitehall Court, which is where their first offices were, which were taken over in the war, and the incumbents were thrown out to make way for the cabinet office. Then it moved up to close to Parliament, then it moved under the Treasury, and then it moved into its current office. These 11 cabinet secretaries, very remarkable men. They're all men, they're all English, they are all middle class, mostly upper middle class background, highly influential, and just as in the same way as the Prime Minister, the first Prime Minister, Walpole, the longest serving of these cabinet secretaries was the first, Maurice Hankey, 22 years, and he went on, as you know, to become a minister in Chamberlain's government, not very successfully. The man who did as much as Lloyd George to win the First World War and to define the structure of the fighting, of the organisation of government in the Second World War, succeeded by my favourite, I just finished a book on the Cabinet Office published just before Christmas, on the centenary, the son of the poet laureate, Edward Bridges. And it's wonderful seeing his cabinet minutes written in exactly the same way as he wrote his war diary when he was fighting on the Somme in 1916, the same very, very precise handwriting. And he worked and took Churchill through the war, though Churchill's affections came to reside more in the third of these figures, who is Norman Brooke here, who served as cabinet secretary for 15 years, the only cabinet secretary not to see his life go into his 70s, died age 65, had been chairman of the BBC after he left government at the age of 60. Then Bertrand, the first unhappy cabinet secretary, who did not work well with his prime minister, loved Douglas Hume, didn't get on with either Wilson or indeed with Ted Heath. Ted Heath, so strongly European, Trend, very strongly Atlanticist, kept up a back channel of contact all the time with Henry Kissinger to make certain that the British special relationship would still flower even with the obsessive Europeanism of Edward Heath. John Hunt, the Catholic, took over, very strongly Catholic figure, took over and sorted out and restored the primacy of the Cabinet Office after the Trend years. And then Robert Armstrong took over, and the key figure of the 60s and 70s and 80s in civil service power made way for Robin Butler. Loved working with Mrs. Thatcher as Principal Private Secretary. Then it went wrong when he came back to serve her as Cabinet Secretary when he fell out badly with her. And worked very well with Major, not well with Blair. Blair and Campbell and Mandelson called him old Buttleshanks. Wilson, Turnbull, Gus O'Donnell, and now unquestionably the most powerful man, I say that the most powerful man in Britain at the moment is this man there, Jeremy Hayward. Jeremy Hayward has been the dominant official of the last 17 years of this century. So then we're on to, let's just see, the importance of the right education. So let's now look at some of the qualities that we have as Prime Minister. Why do some people get up there and others don't? We're going to go very quickly through this. Eton, 21, so that's a very important requirement. It certainly was. Oxford, 26. Cambridge 14 will be replaced by Westminster if I was giving this talk in a century's time. So clearly having the right social background, this is a limited option for the vast majority of those born in this country, particularly if you're a woman. You had no hope at all until 1979, and if you didn't go to the right school or to the right university, little hope also. But let's remember that there are some very significant figures in this century, last century. Major there, you can just see Callaghan, Churchill, MacDonald and Lloyd George, but including Disraeli and Wellington, did not go to any university at all, even though Wellington played a core role in the founding of King's College London. Right. What about height? Height. Who would anyone here say who the tallest and who the shortest Prime Minister is? Jim Callaghan, tallest. Shortest? Okay, we're going to have a look. Tallest is Salisbury. And Callaghan, tall. Cameron, 6'1". Pitt, about 6 foot. And comparing that to presidents, Lincoln, Johnson, Jefferson, Washington, Bush. You could say there, perhaps with the exception of the last, some might cavil a bit about Johnson too, that height clearly matters, but the shortest, Theresa May coming down to Spencer Percival, clearly being very short is not a great recommendation for longevity, and that same goes in the US. What about age? Is there a distribution curve that says that you need to be old enough to learn about the job, but if you're too old, you can become too tired, haven't got the same energy that you once had? How does that work? Well, let's look at the youngest. The youngest Prime Minister of all was William Pitt the Younger. So let's just look at this now. Astonishing, 24 years of age coming through here to Grafton at 33, Rockingham at 35, Devonshire 36. So the pattern very much 18th, 19th century figures were younger. North 37. 37, it's very significant, I think, in terms of experience. Blair 43, and then the youngest Prime Minister for 198 years, and I think this was very significant for him also, David Cameron. David Cameron was in many ways above all a young Prime Minister. He made the mistakes of a young man repeatedly. We can maybe ask about that. Some of his misjudgments over Libya, over the Syria vote in August 2013, the pivotal moment, the pivotal week in the history of the last decade was the moment that the West, Obama was all ready to go. He was all ready to fire his cruise missiles at the Assad regime and deplete the regime. And in all probability, Assad would have fallen in August 13 had they been fired. Putin was expecting Assad to fall that autumn. He said, no, we cannot do that. We can't do it because of Iraq. We have to get parliamentary agreement. Miliband said that his troops were online Labour Party MPs, and it didn't happen. Mistake of a younger man, maybe. Maybe that was prudent. His rashness was the rashness of a young person. But let's look at age. Can you be too old? Campbell Bannerman, well, he had so many limitations. Age was certainly perhaps one of them. Russell, 73, and I think in your 70s in the 19th century, with less good diet and less knowledge about how to look after the body, was, you add 10 years on in terms of experience today, 74, Palmerston, Churchill's 76. He was 3 weeks off his 77th birthday on the 30th of November 1951. So 77 when he came back. 82, Gladstone, the oldest Prime Minister, 82, remarkable. This is undoubtedly too old. I think there is a distribution where you need to be experienced enough, but not too old. Experienced enough to learn how to do the job, coming back to that a bit later. Let's just now here just say, does drink and womanizing count against success? We could put the equivalent there for Theresa May and Margaret Thatcher, but who were the great soaks, the great drinkers? Walpole, a massive drinker. Pitt the Younger, who, as I'm sure you know, it's not apocryphal, was advised to help his headaches to drink a bottle of port a day by his doctor. When the headaches continued, the prescription went up to two to three bottles of port a day. Which is a lot. Addington probably accounts for the fact that we don't even know who he is. Contributing powerfully to that. And perhaps can we just move on, because I'm not certain that this... Derby, Rosebery there, Asquith drinking far too much. Churchill, certainly with his Paul Roger champagne and his brandy, drunk too much. Wilson, by 1975-76, his principal private secretary told me quite early on that it was pointless talking to Wilson after a certain time, after 5 o'clock in the evening, when he came back in power in the 1970s, because his brain was addled. And she loved her tipple too. There's a little sign that affected her judgment. And what about womanizers? Well, there's so many here. I mean, I'll just read out that quotation there. Most of the prime ministers I've known have been adulterers, said Gladstone. Walpole, I don't know where to begin with Walpole. Wellington, clearly. Melbourne, enormously. Palmerston, Gladstone himself. Asquith, who wrote love letters to his daughter's best friend, or one of his best friends, Venetia Stanley, even during cabinet meetings. Lloyd George, who was the first prime minister since the 19th century openly to live with his mistress in Downing Street. And Harold Wilson. So doesn't seem to have counted against them any more than it has with American presidents. What about now, let's look at other ways, how has technology and transport, just this very quickly, to give you a sense of how the job has changed since those early figures that we saw there in the 18th century, how both the mode of communication enormously expanding what the Prime Minister can do, communicate, how they themselves can travel around, these early 18th century Prime Ministers, barely ever venturing beyond London, the 19th century Prime Ministers, again, very much land-tied. The 20th century is when the Prime Minister begins to move outside themselves, the first Prime Minister to go to the US, Ramsay MacDonald, the first Prime Minister to travel abroad, Disraeli. So it just gives you a sense here. So the early movement, communication letters took a long time to write, revolutionized by telegraph lines there from the middle of the 19th century onwards, enormously extended the power of the Prime Minister and accelerated that trend that I spoke about the Prime Minister effectively becoming the Foreign Secretary when he can communicate directly and in real time with his opposite number in other countries, on then to the teleprinter, telegram, onto the telephone, coming into Downing Street from the 1890s. And then coded intelligence coming through from the 1920s, email from the 1970s, and mobile phones from the early mobile phones here, and that's, I think, the real size there. down to fast liquor. And this, of course, creates great problems with records for prime ministers, because they much sooner just call their mates and who's then listening in on a call and what records are kept. And then looking at the method of communication, that is Wellington on Copenhagen, when he became prime minister for the first time, he rode into Downing Street on Copenhagen, even though it had been 13 years since Waterloo. Just look at how their power, their ability to rule, to see things, to govern the country, to see things for themselves, expanded the sedan chair, the carriage in the 18th century, the carriage in the 19th century. There you can see rather self-conscious Gladstone. Here you can see Gladstone in the 19th century, and this here looks suspiciously like the circle line coming around the north belt of the circle with a train. That is Balfour, and that's his De Dion Voiturette. He was the first prime minister, 1902 to 1905, to bring a car into Downing Street. Again, expanded his power, ocean liners in the 1930s and battleships, and then the first use of aircraft there, Neville Chamberlain coming back. That's at Heston Airport there. And then jet aircraft. The first prime minister used jet aircraft. That is it's a 707. That there is Macmillan. And then the first prime minister used a helicopter. There we see Macmillan coming through to Camp David in 1960. What then about the a spouse? How lonely that job is, and how important it is to have a spouse who is going to be supportive. Definitely a figure behind the more successful prime ministers. And just think how unsuccessful most prime ministers have been since 1945, even with many of these advantages. So the top spouses, I would say, is Robert Peel's wife there, Julia, formidable hostess and mentor, guide, Catherine Gladstone. You can see, that's a great photo, isn't it? Just see there the proud Gladstone with the, just look at that face. It's a beautifully composed photograph that tells a powerful story about their relationship. We now see Clementine in the White Room, which is a favorite room in Downing Street. It's the room on the corner up above the Cabinet Room. It's a double-fronted room there. There's a picture of young Winston. She loves sitting in that window seat there in the White Room, looking out over Horse Guards. This way here looks out over, towards me, looks out over St. James's Park. This is the back part of the palace, the part put up in the 17th century after George Downing's block at the front. And then Dennis, remarkable consort, and played the part, got his role. And I think Philip May might well be up there. Philip May proving to be an extraordinary support to Theresa. Unhappier spouses, will there be many? That is Wellington's poor wife. Palmerston, multiple philanderer. Asquith, she looks pretty unhappy, doesn't she? I mean, whoever painted that, I mean, goodness. I don't know what she's trying to do there. And look how long she lived, however. And there we all know, perhaps, about the relationship that she had with Boothby, which he never found out. But he was very innocent. So when in 1961 he brought J.F. Kennedy, the new president, down to Birchgrove, his house in Sussex, and Kennedy didn't quite know how to relate to him, and tried as an opening gambit at the lunch table, he said, "I find if I don't have a woman before lunch, I get a headache. What about you?" And Macmillan had no idea what Kennedy was talking about. Absolutely no idea, any more than he knew that his wife had had a 40-year affair with the bounder of the Conservative Party, Bob Boothby. She was so unhappy, she insisted that in his second term in power, 74 to 76, that she lived in nearby, they lived together in nearby Lord North Street, to get away from Marcia Williams. Okay, what about experience? Well, experience certainly helps. Experience here coming round to the fact that Newcastle had 30 years of experience, Goderich 11 prime, previous posts, Churchill 9, Macmillan 7, Callaghan was the great figure of the 20th century to be Home Secretary and Foreign Secretary and Chancellor. By the way, it's a great advantage to Theresa May to be Home Secretary because unlike those who've come in from Foreign Secretary and being Chancellor of the Exchequer, which are basically offices where you can plan ahead, the Home Secretary has to be very reactive, and that's undoubtedly helped her cope with the fact that she's had to be very reactive. All Prime Ministers are very hard if you come in from the Treasury or the Foreign Office without that kind of experience. Many are enormously unexperienced, and I think it certainly showed with both Blair and with Cameron, the fact they had not been in charge of anything. I mean, in the private sector or the public sector before. So how important is it to be an intellectual? Well, here are the intellectuals I'm listing here. We can form our own list. Disraeli, a novelist, Gladstone, extraordinary thinker, Rosebery, Lloyd George himself, Churchill, a writer, was he an intellectual? Certainly a historian, a wordsmith. Attlee, Macmillan, the last Prime Minister to read avidly at Downing Street, Balfour, philosopher, Harold Wilson, Oxbridge Don, and Gordon Brown, a historian. To be clever isn't necessarily an advantage. We're just trying to work out, does it help to be a toff? Houghton Hall is where Walpole was based, Chatham House, and Chatham House now in London in St. James's Square is where Pitt the Elder was based, Apsley House, Wellington's quiet pad at number one, London. His London house couldn't bear living in number 10, far too stuffy and pokey. Palmerston in Cambridge House, I'm sure you know that house in Piccadilly. And Hughenden, which Disraeli brought to make him feel grand. That's Gladstone up in North, just inside North Wales. Then we have the great Salisbury House, Marquess of Salisbury at Hatfield, just north of London. Then on to recognising that Prime Ministers could no longer afford to have these kind of houses. Lord Lee of Fareham in 1911 gave this for Prime Ministers, recognising there was a change in social class so they could have a country house in Buckinghamshire to go to. That didn't stop Churchill going ahead and buying this house there, Chartwell. And I then put in Lord North Street, which I mentioned earlier, which Marcia forced Harold to live in his last 2 years in power. So does it help to have a lot of money? I think now it positively helps not to have a lot of money. I think one of Theresa May's successes is that she comes, like John Major, as I said earlier, from a more humble home. Greatest orators, we do this enormously quickly. Pitt the Elder, perhaps one of the greatest, Pitt the Younger, hard to know. We can't hear their voices. We can just read their speeches. We can read the account of their speeches. Canning, albeit his short time at number 10. Peel, a great orator. Derby, it would be wonderful if we had their voices and we could listen to them. Gladstone, clearly strong. And the ability to project to Disraeli, Asquith, extraordinary. Lloyd George, probably the greatest orator of the 20th century as Prime Minister. Churchill, perhaps more of a wordsmith than an orator. There's a difference there. Who then, bringing this all together, might be the best Prime Ministers? Grey, I'm putting up there at number 10, 1832, Great Reform Bill, and sorted out the country after the Wellington, helped bring peace and order. Lloyd George, for his work in the First World War, bringing it to a successful conclusion by November 1918. Attlee, the creator of the welfare state and arguably, perhaps quite easy to argue, Labour's greatest Prime Minister, and more controversially, the greatest peacetime Prime Minister of the 20th century. Disraeli, for his work on social reform, on empire, on foreign policy, on the sense of adapting the body politic to the expanding electorate. Margaret Thatcher, most controversially, won't go into that now. Peel for his work on the economy, restoring the country's finances, introducing social reform. Walpole for creating the office of First Minister or Prime Minister. Gladstone for his great budgets as Chancellor and his sense of moral purpose as Prime Minister, even though Ireland remained a project that was too far for him. Pitt the Younger, probably the most stylish of all Prime Ministers who created the 19th century state in Britain, and the greatest of all, I put down, of course this is my personal list, and that leaves him. Interestingly, great as a wartime leader, though I argued in the first book that I wrote, he was not as successful as a peacetime Prime Minister, but he was a much better peacetime Prime Minister than history had allowed so far. So we're just going to then, let's look at 10 worst. Okay, I mean, I'm just going to go quickly through Wilmington, Newcastle, it's too grim. Rosebery, life is too short, Goderich. But just on to Norse, who is there because of the loss of the American colonies, Prime Minister at the time of the American War of Independence. Aberdeen took the country into the Crimean War, couldn't have any kind of control over his cabinet whatsoever, and then left when the war was going badly. Not a great sense. So there he seems to have a picture of the Acropolis there. I don't quite know what he's thinking of there. And then Neville Chamberlain, and worst of all, who would agree with this? Worst of all, you're wanting me to say Blair, you're wanting me to say Thatcher, I'm going to say... because he not only made a catastrophic error of judgment that damaged peace in the Middle East and damaged Britain's reputation, but lied about it, and was also pretty lousy as a domestic prime minister also. So we're just going to go through now, just concluding here very quickly, what then are the qualities? What do you need to be a successful Prime Minister? What is the riddle of Downing Street, which was the question I was asked? Make your impact early. Most leave it too late. Peel, Gladstone, Asquith, Attlee made it early. Go to Oxford rather than Cambridge, very important. Be well above average height or well below it. Salisbury, Blair, Cameron, tall. Lloyd George, Churchill, Thatcher, short. Drink, but not too much. So Pitt, Asquith, Wilson all drank too much. Indeed, it killed them. Arguably played a role in killing all of them. Have a supportive spouse. Very, very important because it's such a lonely job. Six. Don't succeed a strong predecessor. Fatal. No one take over after Gladstone or after Churchill. It gave Rosebery and Eden a real nightmare. Take over after somebody weak. Have experience, but don't be too old. And Baldwin got it right. Peel got it right there in the middle point of that graph. Be healthy and avoid illness. So many prime ministers have suffered from physical or mental health. Have a good crisis, have a good war, and don't screw it up. North and Eden got it wrong. The greats, Thatcher, Churchill, Lloyd George, Liverpool got it right. And don't be too clever. Don't be too intellectual because you think of too many options. And finally, don't get zapped, very important. There you are, number 10, the closest it came to falling in 1780, the Gordon riots. Spencer Percival, not a great thing to do, avoid being killed. Four American presidents out of 45 have been assassinated, only one out of 55. So you have a 2% chance if you're British, but a 10% chance if you are American. Don't even say it. Cato conspiracy, 1820, Robert, which was the plan to assassinate the whole of the cabinet. Robert Peel there is the man who tried to kill him. His right-hand man was killed instead. There was a plot to kill Lloyd George, There, the Daily Sketch. It must be true because it's in the press. There, the Lloyd George murder plot. And it was called the pear tree because the poison smelt of pear trees that was going to be used. Churchill, multiple attempts to try and kill him. Nuclear war, which have now been handed over to marijuana growing societies, appreciation societies across the country. Douglas Hume was tried to be assassinated by a group of students who arrived at his house in Scotland during the 1964 campaign. They didn't quite know what they were going to do, and his very wily housekeeper gave them all some beer and then gave them some more beer and then phoned the police, by which time they were going nowhere. The police then arrested them. A true story that was covered up. I mean, it's hardly a very serious plot. This plot was obviously far more serious. You may or may not have seen that picture about that was what it was like after the IRA bombers caused the damage. As you know, they'd taken over the room below and they'd prized up the floorboards, put the explosive in time to go off, and that was where they were. This was the mortar attack to take revenge for Bobby Sands, but by then Margaret Thatcher had gone and John Major had taken over, and that was when they planned the mortar attack. The Prime Minister was under constant attack, and was taken. The Prime Minister had in his plane a near miss with a rebel rocket coming in. So dangerous, and then I think we can therefore conclude with what we have there. It is a dangerous task. I don't know who would want it. It's only £160,000 or so. Long hours, flat, a nice flat that goes with the job. But most people who have it end in tears. And finally, and because I can do this much more quickly, I'm just very quickly going to show you now a 3-minute clip about what I have distilled here from what makes a successful Prime Minister. And there are 10 things I think that Prime Ministers need to do, my voice is absolutely going, and the one thing that's wrong here is I asked the BBC crew when we made this what I should say at the beginning. They said, say that you've written biographies on almost all the post-war prime ministers. So I then said, I've written biographies on almost all the post-war prime ministers. Actually, I haven't. I don't know why I said that. That was just kind of parroting what they said. I have written on most of the post-war prime ministers, but I've only written biographies on four, Major, Blair, Brown, and Cameron to date. So this is my distilled wisdom, and this would just be a way of tidying everything up and then going into questions before the test.
Right.
And questions.
I just want to say, first of all, thank you, Professor Seldon, because you practically wrote my undergraduate thesis bibliography, so thank you for that. And my question is somewhat linked to my thesis. In, obviously, 1974, we had the aborted attempt to form a Liberal-Conservative coalition under Ted Heath, and that failed dramatically and ended Heath's premiership. And then in 2010, we had a successful attempt which lasted the full 5 years. How do you think the differences in the leadership styles and premierships of Heath and Cameron helped to contribute to the failure and success of those two attempts?
The question specifically is did the failure of the Heath government lead to the loss of the majority to make the question of a Lib Dem, of a Lib Conservative coalition possible? Is that the question? Heath was not a great Prime Minister. He was a very poor communicator. I've never met anybody so rude in all my life. I tried to help him. I remember one occasion we went out to dinner. This is just personal experience, but it's quite typical of him. And his food came first because they were all petrified of him at the hotel. Mine came much later. He'd finished his course when mine came, and he said, "Right, that's it," and we went off. We went back to work. He lacked the skills that you need to have to be a Prime Minister. He was much too intellectual. He saw things in his head he didn't see. He saw an imaginary world, not a real world, of human beings and people, and it was untenable. And his cabinet were very loyal to him from 70 to 74 through appalling times. He lost his head of civil service, William Armstrong, who had to be taken out of Number 10 in a straitjacket. The pressure got far too much for him. He was held together by Robert Armstrong, whose picture, no relation of William Armstrong, whose picture I showed up there. He was not, he didn't command his party, he didn't command the government. There were too many policies and it was too belligerent. He hadn't rolled the pitch enough. And Gordon Brown, I think, had similar traits. I mean, personally, I think that Gordon Brown was the most tragic prime minister of the post-war period because he, like Eden, had waited for too long to be prime minister. And Eden, by the time he took over in April 55, having waited for 15 years since 1940, really was too old and angry. And I think that anger was the great problem for Brown, waiting for 10 years, seeing the years of fat and wealth and political capital and economic strength dissipate. By the time he took over, he saw that he went straight into the crash, had very little left, but was a very highly principled, both in terms of foreign policy and domestic policy, profoundly compassionate. One of the great Gordon Brown moments, if one wants to see him, is the way he responded in the House of Commons when David Cameron's son died. And he's extraordinary. He lost his own daughter, Jennifer, as I'm sure you know. But he wasn't a successful prime minister. Maybe it was simply too late. Maybe no one could have taken the party forward in May 2007 after Blair. And therefore, again, we had exactly the same position of insufficient numbers and trying to hold a government together in coalition with the Liberals. The big difference is that had he's done that with the Liberals in 1974, with the then leader of the Liberal Party, not Nick Clegg as in 2010, but it was Jeremy Thorpe. Then we now know from Joe Haynes, who was Wilson's press secretary, that they had information about him having a very seedy, corrupt life, being involved in a murder and all kinds of unattractive behaviour, and that would have come out, that would have scuppered the government. So even had they reached successful conclusion to those talks, there would have been a great national scandal that would have demeaned the nation while Labour fed that material into the blood system of the nation. That was the material around Norman Scott, etc. I'll do much shorter on answers, but they're so interesting questions.
The lady next.
Yes.
Very short question.
Yes.
Hello, Anthony. Is it true or not, in your opinion, that the British Prime Minister has more power than the President of the greatest nation on earth?
Yes. Well, I think that the French Prime Minister is a remarkable figure. We're talking about the past. Yep. Now, put very simply, and of course, this is not science. It's commentary and it's argument. The American President has less power relative to the Prime Minister. Directly relative, but the authority of the country and the spending power of the American president is vastly greater. So less power directly, but a much bigger stage that they're acting on. And of course, the American president is head of state, but with the separation of powers, with Congress, and with the judiciary, with the division of powers between the centre and the states. These are powerful factors with interest groups. It does mean that the power of the American president, as we saw with Obama, as we saw with both Bushes, it's very hard to be an effective president. And one wonders that the thesis of Schlesinger, the imperial presidency, but then it collapsed in 1973, that one wonders how long, if the Trump presidency collapses also, how long it will be before then many more academic texts saying that the core problem with the American presidency is the lack of power and do we need to beef it up. The Prime Minister, I think the power is very considerable if they know how to apply it. So all they need to do is to switch on YouTube and look up a program about the 10 keys and make careful notes. Being serious, many of them muck it up. They muck it up willfully because they don't learn. They all come into, this is true of not just political leaders in this country, it's true of football managers, it's true of people taking over, whatever, you'll know this from your own careers, heads, vice chancellors, whatever job it is, they have little time, they need to differentiate themselves, they don't listen very carefully and understand, and they know very little history also. So I think that the Prime Ministers would be vastly more successful if they were a little bit wiser, a little bit more respectful to their predecessors, understood more, and took time to reflect and be considered about what they really wanted to do. The history of most Prime Ministers is one of disappointment, looking back from retirement, from tranquility, with bitterness, saying, if only we had done this. And the other thing they need to do is clearly practice mindfulness or meditate. And then that would make them more considered and thoughtful because they get far too caught up. Let's take questions in the back.
Would you like to offer us a little list of your favourites among the politicians who never made it but might have been?
Okay, can we just take from the audience five just hands up here. Who are our top five people? And I'll say then, having heard them, whether you got any of them right. So who are we going to have? Our favourite people who never made it. Yes.
Roy Jenkins,
the mentor of the great liberal reformer under Wilson, Home Secretary, and the mentor to Blair. Yeah.
John Smith,
the Labour Prime Minister, died of a heart attack in the morning of the 12th of May, 1994. Barbara Castle would have been very interesting and successful as the first Labour female Prime Minister.
Rad Butler
almost made it. Rad Butler, the Chancellor of the Exchequer. I think the tragedy for Rad Butler was that what happened in December 1954, his then wife, Sidney Courtauld, died. He then married a very lovely woman called Molly, but whereas Molly kept on saying to him, Rab, you're wonderful, why don't they realise this? Sidney was constantly criticising him and holding him to the mark. And if you had the rather self-indulgent personality and intellect that Rad Butler had, you needed to have somebody who was constantly reprimanding you and holding you to making you think and giving a critical, being a critical friend rather than somebody who constantly praised you. And that was the undoing of Rad Butler, who almost made it in 57 and then almost made it in 63, but was too old by 65 when Ted Heath, it needed to go down a generation, which is why Ted Heath got it when Alice Douglas Hume went. And the final one is
Quinton Hogg,
well, son of the great, so I think this is a magnificent, anyone we've left out there?
Heseltine,
yes. Heseltine would have made life much more fun. I think I just finish off by saying this whole, we look at these people and it all seems to be in history foregone conclusions. We saw the pictures of 54 people up there, and because we see their pictures and we know that they were in power, there is that assumption that they all could have, they all were somehow preordained to have got there. None of them were preordained to have got there. One of the most surprising prime ministers of all was Theresa May. She might have thought herself she wanted it, but for a whole series of factors coming together and the timing was resulted in her being there. And you know, the puzzle, I'm so leave you with the surprise, and I agree with that list very much indeed. I think that's an absolutely excellent list. A lot of them would have, I think, have been more successful. The history of post-war premiership, but the history of pre-war premiership too, is by and large unsuccessful prime ministers, many ending in tears, unlike great chairs of council, who are obviously very successful. And why would anyone want this job? I'm writing a book at the moment called Life After 10. And one of the questions I'm asking, how many children of prime ministers would be want to be proud now of having been? You would think they'd be incredibly proud, but so many of them have left, and the job is so harsh. With Winston Churchill, had five children, only one of them, admittedly one of them died when a child, young, but three out of four of them died from the effect of alcohol abuse or drug abuse, mental problems. It's very, very hard. One of Eden's children died tragically and got AIDS, and it's very hard. Macmillan's, Morris Macmillan, alcohol, just think about the children. To take that job, they are berated from the moment that they get in there. Everyone's wanting to kill them. I just gave you a quick sense of some of the more better-known plots, but they're constant plots that are being foiled. Everyone's trying to kill you or kidnap your children. You leave in tears. You're reviled. You don't get $73 million for your memoirs. You have the Mail examining you all the time and castigating you and making you out to be a complete failure. Who on earth would want it? And just let me ask you a final question. Who here, if life had been different, would have fancied, even after all that, being Prime Minister? Two. And I think they definitely deserve a round of applause for their brazenness. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. If I could just say, I'm Roland Dunwright, I'm the Deputy Vice-Chancellor here, and on behalf of the University, a really very big thank you to Sir Anthony for giving such a scintillating and fascinating talk, and also to welcome you back as an alumnus of this University, formerly the Polytechnic of Central London, and we're delighted to know that you learnt more here than you did at a PP at another institution, as you mentioned. I was a bit wondering when you mentioned you were going to go through all 55 prime ministers, 11 principal secretaries, was it 246 slides, whether you were going to be able to manage that, but you have done it with enormous aplomb and enormous success. We've learnt a lot of facts, a lot of interesting aspects about all the previous prime ministers, and I'm very pleased to say that now you have a choice. As an audience, and you've been a fantastic audience, is whether you would like to stay here for a three-hour exam and test on the various parts of what you've learnt, or you can alternatively come through and have a drink in our foyer of the university when you come out just on the left. So at this point, I'd just like to say a very big thank you, and again, if we could just congratulate our speaker for such a wonderful talk.